Hey everybody, it is Grimmy Genius Thursday, and today is another Thursday that Christina's family brings out a music video, a new music video from Side A. I listened to Anybody's You at two different times during the day. I listened to it this morning. And I got one message from it, and then I listened to it a couple hours ago, and I got another message to it. You guys are probably seeing this Friday morning, because when I uploaded, or when I went to go and do this video, a whole lot of stuff was going on Facebook regarding myself and my showcase to Friday. Which is kind of funny, because in the video she talks about her showcase on Friday, and I kind of felt like, girl, you're talking to me though. Like, we there. We totally there. So, yeah. But let me put on the video so that I can give you guys my step-by-step commentary. I totally wanted that red chair, by the way. Oh my god, I wanted that red chair. Anyway, okay, let me play it, and then I'll just go step-by-step with y'all. Okay, so I like how she did a continuation from the first video with the outfit and everything. I still want to know about that garter, though. I literally had to watch the beginning about a few times to see what that text message said, because I knew it was going to just catapult the entire video. And again, I love this little flashing that's happening, because it's like you're behind her eyes. Acting like it's nothing, but I'm feeling like a fool. And something's gotta break. And I just love the way her voice is during this whole thing. And that chair, that red chair that's broken. I was like, yes, that's your heart you sitting on, honey. And then this female. I love this whole setup. Of you don't know who the female is, you don't know who the male is, because they did it in the first video. I thought it was a great transition into the next video. Absolutely love. See, when I first heard this in the morning, I saw the light when she was sitting in the chair, and I'm thinking, maybe she's talking about God, maybe she's talking about herself. That she's the person. And I think that was the message that I needed at the moment. Because I was getting a lot of slander in the morning. And so I thought, like, she was talking to me, and God was talking to me like, you are the person that you need to love. You are the person that you need to be there for. Right? And I love this shadowy figure, her on the steps. It's beautiful. Beautiful, beautiful, beautiful treatment. And then I love how the other female is walking through the steps, and you see the spiderweb kind of vibe on the stairs. I thought that's a great way to kind of separate them. I love the cinematic distance that they're creating. And again, the light, I thought she was talking about God and herself when I listened to it the first time. But the second time, I realized that it could also be taken that she's trying to find a man. And who is that anybody that she's looking for? Which I thought it was great. And, like, I love the subtlety that you can think that it's God, or you can think that it's a person because of her personality and who she is. She's a very God-fearing woman. So to see how that light is sitting on the red chair, the red broken chair that's mended together. Beautiful. And then this moment, y'all. This moment when she realized that the chick is her. It was like, bam. And that dress is bad, though. Them shoes, too. I really think I have a dress like that in my closet. I might wear it today, in honor of, I might wear it, well, today, because it's, like, in the AM. In honor of my friend who passed away, Blackberry Molasses. Her hair was blue. She had blue dreads. But, yeah, that dress is bad. Them shoes is bad. That hair is bad. But that dude, though. No. You need to be calling her out better than that. You need to be calling her out better than that. I'm sorry. You really don't love her if you just say her name once. Come on now. No. Pause, rewind, and do that over. Okay, now this cinematic sequence here of continuing now with the mom is great. I personally don't like the mom. She came off a little too harsh, though.
What's wrong, and you angrily tell me nothing, you dash out.
At least you know how this goes.
Jessica, what is it?
I don't know.
And I was here with y'all. I was here with her. I was crying too. Like this was my monologue too, man.
Because everybody knows I'm just gonna crash and burn with that too. So
it must be me then, right?
And that though, it's always us. Drop the mic. It must be me, but it's always us. I was like, oh my goodness, light bulb. It's always us. We always got to work on something. We always got to learn to love ourselves. And that's how I thought, like, it was, okay, anybody's you could be me. Could be my own self that I got to love. My own self that I got to look for. My own self that got to hear me. My own self that got to, you know, fill my soul with whatever heart, my heart desire is. It could be just me. Or, as I said, the light by her chair is like God and everything. Let's see. Again, at the end, she drops the mic with just that thought. And knowing Christina and knowing that she was like, you know, we got to love ourselves and we got to be ourselves. And being ourselves is the only thing that we got to do. That kind of also leads into that message as well. What are my other notes I have? Her lyrics, though. Those lyrics, though. They was touching my heart for real, for real. Because I'm getting tired, too, man. I'm getting tired trying to look for somebody that God told me that I'm supposed to have, right? But then again, he says, when a man findeth a wife, he findeth a good thing. So we technically, females, shouldn't be looking. So when we look and we're going to find something that we don't need, because God said in the Bible, when a man findeth a wife. So that means men, get your life together and go look for yourself a female that you want to, a woman, a queen that you want to spend the rest of your life with. That's what it is. Females, just be yourself, do you, he will come. He will come because that's what God said in the Bible, and I believe what God said in the Bible, and I know Christina believed what God said in the Bible, so we should be doing that. So stop trying to chase these men. Stop trying to change yourself so that they love you. Just be you and do you. And the man will come. And so like this here with Jesse coming and following the dude all the way up to the balcony and stuff and the rooftop. We shouldn't be doing that. If he is for us, God will make him for us, and there is no way that he can deny that he's for us. When God made you somebody, you will know. So you ain't got to be following nobody all the way up to no rooftop to try and figure out who this other female is that's talking to your man. Because if your man is your man, he ain't going to be looking at nobody else. If he's looking at somebody else, he's looking at them to say, baby, isn't she pretty? And then she's going to be look like, nah, but I got a dime piece right here. Or I got the most beautiful girl in the room. Or he ain't even going to look at nobody because he's going to be like, all he's thinking about is you. And that you are filling up the room. So we ain't got to do all that. So I was with you the whole time. I understood your sentiment, Christina. I did with the song and everything. But as far as the girl in the video, Jessica, she shouldn't be doing that. If she's a God-fearing woman like you are, I know you're acting, so, you know, just bear with me. If she's a God-fearing woman like you are, then she shouldn't be following no man. She shouldn't be following no man because the man should be coming to her. And you know when it's made for you, when things just are puzzle pieces and they fit right together. So all of that shouldn't have been happening. I know it's a song, I know you're acting, but I'm just saying. Because you're Christina, and I know who you are, and I know your personality and everything like that. No Christ-fearing woman should be following no man anywhere. No Christ-fearing woman should be following a man mad stealthily because she thinks that he's with another woman. Because then that means God is trying to tell you that that's not the man that I made for you. So you just be happy that you found out mad early and can get to stepping. But it was so funny because in the morning when I saw this after I did my session at my internship, it was completely in relation to what we were talking about a few minutes prior when the female think like there's something wrong with us, and the man goes and cheats. But we ask the men in the session, like, can you give the female perspective and say, what really is it? And they're always like, nah, it's not the female. It's something in the man where they got to go and find somebody else. And I said, I made a comment because I've seen it before. I made a comment. I said, you know what the worst thing is when the other woman looks exactly like you. You put a split screen up and you ain't know who's who. That's the worst when the other woman looks exactly like you. She might be a little taller. She might be like a couple pounds thinner. She might have wider hips. But she look exactly like you. And you looking at yourself like, really though? You left me for somebody that looks like me though? So you obviously liked me. There's something about me that you like. So you went and go found me a twin to be with because you couldn't be with me. That, to me, was the worst thing. And she said, you know what? That means that there really is something inside of him because he went and went find your twin. So there was something about you that he couldn't deal with. Or there's something about him with you that he couldn't deal with. So he needed to figure out if he found somebody else, would that thing persist? Because if you found somebody else that looked exactly like you, then that means that, yeah, there is something in him. And if whatever he is unbalances, then he'll notice that it's him and not the female because the female looked exactly like you, the one that he just left. I was like, you know what? True story. It hit me at the moment in the morning of, like, I need to learn to love myself. We all need to learn to love ourselves. And we all need to look inside ourselves for happiness and for love first before we can look outside and find love in someone else. And then when I watched it again to do more commentary, I understood the male portion of it. But good job, Christina. Good job. I love it. You know, I always have issue with a lot of things, but I appreciate the artisticness. But for real, though, can I get that chair? Awesome realness. Can I get that chair? If her brother and her family is listening, can I get that chair, though? Because that chair, to me, represents so much. Because it's a red chair. And red, you know, in all of this, represents love. And then the fact that the chair is broken and it's mended in a way that's created art, meaning that we can take our broken heart and mend it, and it still be functional and beautiful. Alright, so whenever we're heartbroken, we can still mend ourselves and be beautiful. And that leads me to tell y'all about my event tonight. The official name of the event is Kintsugi Poetics. Kintsugi is the exact thing what I was explaining with the chair, where something is broken and you mend it together. But you know what's the nice Japanese thing about Kintsugi? Is that you mend it together with gold so that the new piece is more priceless than the piece that it started out with. So what I'm doing tonight is a hodgepodge event of music, live poetry, live painting, live dancing, and live body painting to kind of help us learn how to do Kintsugi on ourselves, how to mend ourselves with something better so that we come out stronger, so that we come out more beautiful in our mending through self-expression and through poetry and art. So I'm going to take you through everything that's going on in the live space psychologically so you can know what the process is of an artist, what the process is of a poet, what the process is of a dancer, what they're drawing from when they hear words, to create the art that they're creating, or how from a blank piece of paper can a person put their pain and then spit it for you on the microphone. You guys are going to get an inside look of that psychological process, because let alone I'm a therapist and I'm an artist. So I can give you both perspectives, and I am qualified to do so. Because I do have a pending license. I'm working on getting my full therapy license. So I did go to counseling school, Columbia University at that. So if anybody was asking, I am a Columbia Lion, and I am considering going back to Columbia for my doctorate. I'm going to be doing my dissertation in creative arts and suicide, trying to identify through longitudinal study from when we individuate ourselves at 12, meaning when we figure out who we want to be at 12 years old, all the way up until 18, all the way up until semi-adulthood, to see whether our mental state, whether we can kind of follow the mental illness or the mental fragility of creative beings from 12 to 18, and see if somewhere along the lines there, with the caveat of family support, we can mitigate the potential of suicidality in creative heads. In creative minds, because I wondered that a lot with all these celebrities committing suicide and all these actors committing suicide. It really touched me, especially Robin Williams. I'm gonna cry right now. Especially Robin Williams, because he was my man from the jump, like the genie in the Aladdin. Like, I'm going to see Aladdin next weekend. That genie. And, like, me and Jasmine, we were on the same plane. Like, I was feeling her. Like, that was my name for months. If you don't believe me, ask my parents. That was my name for months. Jasmine. I loved Aladdin, everything. And Robin Williams was my light because he found beauty in what was weird. And I was weird at 12. Okay? I was bullied at 12. I was weird at 12. So I want to use their deaths and the mental illness in the art community and try and figure it out so that we don't got to think that later on in life we're going to get to that point where we might feel like it's hopeless. So I want to bring that to the creative arts community, and I want to bring that through creative arts therapy, because that's the only way that I'm realizing that my life is going to work. God gave me psychology and God gave me poetry. So I'm going to merge the two together and try and heal this world, man. So that's kind of how the chair, which is the reason why I want the chair so much, how the chair and my showcase kind of go in hand in hand. Also with my showcase, though, and my dissertation, I'm dedicating it to Black Blair Molasses. Bria Knight, she passed away last weekend from complications of her diabetes with heart failure and kidney failure. She was 30 years old, and she was a light in the Newark poetry community, to the point where the mayor is shouting her out. So, I miss you, Bria. I'm always breathing for you, and every voice, every word going forward is a reflection of your influence on me, same way as every lyric going forward is a reflection of Christina on me. So please, guys, if you're interested in the event, it's Kintsugi Poetics, Kintsugi Poetix on Facebook. If you Facebook search that, you'll find the event. The also ticketing and open mic sign up is Paint y Poesia Volume 1 .ptix.com. PaintyPoesia VOL1.PEATIX.com. I'll put it in the bottom for y'all so y'all can see. I'm still trying to get a videographer so that we can document this, because each event is going to be different. Each event is going to be live, and so each event is going to have different poets, different painters, different dancers, different musicians, different everything. So my next installment is in October, on my birthday, October 22nd. So if anybody comes to the Harlem area, Harlem, New York area, and they want something to do around that weekend, I got you. Just message me on Facebook or send me a comment under the video, and we can get that popping. It's really, the second installment is really looking really great already, because I have some surprise hosts, and I have some people that are going to spit poetry from Amsterdam. So yeah, it's going to be official. This one tonight is official because I got my friend who just finished traveling the world, traveling to London, doing his hip-hop and history thing so soon. I love you. I love you, dude. And then I also have my friend who is one of the four best poetry people in the world, Stephen Willis. He's also hosting the event now, and he's going to be featuring, and I have a whole slew of, like, amazing artists. So if you're in the New York City area and you want to come out tonight, it's 7 o'clock at Brooklyn Colony, come out and see how Kintsugi happens, and how Kintsugi happened in Christina's video with that chair, with that red chair that I love so much. Okay, I talked your ear off now. So y'all got my commentary, y'all got what's going on, my showcase on Friday, like Christina had set for Jesse in her video. Christina, I always love you. Christina, you're always in my words. Brea, you're always in my words. John, you're always in my steps. John is an 18-year-old who passed away from diabetes 3 years ago now. So I know he's fawning over Christina in heaven. I know it. And now that Bria's up there, they having a good old time. Good old time, the three of them. I can't wait to get to heaven to party with them, man. Can't wait to get to heaven to party with them. But anyway, on that note, I love all y'all. Asuka out. Live your life, y'all.